So of course I'm the king of JUCO, right? So I want to bring the, let's talk about JUCO a little bit. Yes.
Yeah.
So let's talk about JUCO, like choosing JUCO over like D1 or D2 or NAIA or whatever the fuck else. Like it doesn't really matter. But like for me, of course, I'm a huge advocate for JUCO. So let's talk a little bit about what you guys think about like taking the JUCO route, you know, for example, for a lot of kids, right?
What do you think about taking the
JUCO
route?
For me, like, it's been a huge stepping stone of my career, really. It really changed my career in such a positive way. That's why I'm a huge advocate for going to JUCO, of course. But I came from a small high school in Canada, right? I played ball there and didn't really get looked at. It was, of course, like 12 years ago or whatever. Mm-hmm. So no one really went up to Canada to look for talent. Right, so unless you're Team Canada guy or whatever, which I never got a chance to play, so I never got looked at. So like, I only got one offer from a JUCO, which ended up being Kobe Community College, which is a school. I still talk to the coach and everything. We're like, it's one of the best experiences of my life, and which is why I'm a huge advocate for the 2 years I spent in JUCO. Were life changing. You know, I went from a small JUCO or a small high school in Canada to going to a small JUCO in Kansas, and then after 2 years there, I went to University of South Florida, which is a pretty big D1 for me. Like, it was a huge life-changing experience.
I never knew you went to South Florida.
Yeah.
Really? Yeah.
I never knew that.
Yeah.
That's tight.
I was in South Florida for a year, and I ended up getting drafted by the Giants after that. So again, like, my career went from like having zero to getting drafted, which was the end goal for me at the time.
Right.
So it was a huge stepping stone. And of course, when you go to JUCO, like, you get nothing, you know, but you learn how to survive. I was in the middle of fucking nowhere in Kansas, bro. Like, I'm the only Korean kid, like, fucking walking around. Like, what the fuck is going on? The school's very small, right? I mean, it's just a very small town. I think about town of about, like, maybe 4,000 or 5,000 people. You know, like, it's very small, just a college there, and that's it, out of nowhere. And you just fucking ball out with your homies in the piece of shit dorm, and you just have the greatest time of your life.
What was a better experience for you? Was it JUCO or was it minor league? Because they're both kind of, I mean, kind of shitty situation,
right,
from a housing standpoint, whatever, but you're just kind of in it with your buddies and you gotta kind of bond. And
I like JUCO better just because there's more of a camaraderie there, and you play pro ball too. Like, when you play pro ball, of course, like, you guys are homies and shit like that, but it's not like, it's a little bit different than like a JUCO, for example.
Yeah.
Like, you're there, like, you're with them like 24/7. It's not like they're gonna go up and down to like different teams.
We're here.
We're gonna be here. We're stuck in Kobe, Kansas for two fucking years.
Yeah.
Let's fucking ball out. We're gonna be best friends, or whether you hate me or not, we're gonna be best friends.
Right.
And we're gonna, like, I still talk to some of those guys, right?
Mm-hmm.
I still
talk
to my coach. I went to JUCO 10 years ago, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
so it was, it's definitely life-changing for me. And minor leagues, of course, like, you meet some of your homies there too. And I still talk to a lot of my pro guys, of course, that I play with, but just different, because pro guys, I mean, you play to get moved up. You know, you don't play to get stuck.
You play for yourself.
Yeah, and of course you want to win championships, and you know that.
Yeah.
But at the same time, like, when you're in AA, do they really give a fuck about winning the championship?
And you know that too, because you take your best player and he goes up or he does this, and you're like, oh, I see.
Right,
like,
and throughout the year, I mean, how many of the guys that are starting opening day in minor league, in AA, how many of those guys end up finishing the season? Not that many.
Right.
You know, like, so a lot of up and down, a lot of politics in there as well. And I personally didn't like that, and I never, like, that's why I kind of talk about my minor league days, which it wasn't pretty, but I'm transparent about that.
Yeah.
But in JUCO, there is none of that. It's like, hey, you're homies, and you fucking survive, and you fucking ball out with your homies.
Right.
You do all your fucking grinding together. Like, I remember we got punishment one day. We got caught drinking, of course. I fucking love drinking. That's all we can do. Like, we drank. And then our coach caught us. And then so next day, he fucking got us doing moving, you know, those field like turfs and stuff like that?
Mm-hmm.
Moving from a warehouse all the way to the field, which literally took us 8 hours to do the entire day. And it was fucking freezing, bro. This is like November, December in Kansas. Kansas is super windy, like, windshield just miserable. And we're just like, we're wearing like 3 hoodies, just like, we can't even feel our hands, and we're just doing that. But we did that, you know?
We did
that, and then we have a story, you know, after that. We drank right after that, too. Appreciate you, coach. I love you. But yeah, we drank right. It's just like, you hang out with your boys 24/7. Yeah, just a different, like, lifestyle, you know, like, minor leagues a little bit different.
So here's my angle on the JUCO route. Mm-hmm. I was actually going to go to JUCO.
Really?
Yes.
Incredible.
So I graduated high school early.
Right.
And I didn't think that there's any D1 program out there that would actually accept
early,
me
right.
in the middle of the year.
Right, right, right.
Right. And so I was actually planning on either sitting out mm-hmm. my senior season
right.
and just taking 6 months to literally train, like, not go to school or anything.
Yeah, yeah.
or going to the local community college, local JUCO, and just playing for a year and then transferring into D1 or signing depending on how
it went.
So
incredible.
My question, because so where I come from on that is like, you got to go where you can play and you can continue to develop.
Right.
Because no one coming out of high school is big league ready.
No.
Like even the guys that like Dylan Bundy was one of the closest, right? Mm-hmm. Jose Fernandez was another one that came out of high school and were close to big league ready. But if you look at those guys, like they make their debut and they're still not quite there. They're still very unrefined. They still could use some more development time. So you got to go where you can develop and play because you still got to make strides to become a big leaguer, right? And so if you're not ready at that time to play at a D1, you got to go where you can play so you can be on the field so you can continue to develop. So looking back at your career, when you went to JUCO, how good were you? Were you D1? Could you have played at a D1 out of high school, you think? Or did you have to?
No. And there's a reason I only got one offer out of JUCO. Like, I didn't get any other offers. Now, when I went there, I fucking balled out, especially my sophomore year. Again, you're stuck in such a nowhere.
Yeah.
And that was it for me. Like, for me, it's either I make it in baseball or I'm done. You know, like, and that's a mentality that you really develop when you go to JUCO. Because, again, you don't get shit. Your cafeteria food sucks. I still remember we were going to Texas, 12-hour drive. Okay, our cafeteria prepares our food, and then we get a little lunchbox or whatever. Oh, is this piece of toast or like a piece of bread? Processed cheese, piece of bread. There's like no meat. It's just like mustard packets. I'm like, sick. This is a JUCO way. That's what it is. The bus got so fucking hot. I remember we called it grilled cheese because it ended up melting in the bus, and there's no grilling that was done. You know, it's just, but you go through that, and it just makes you mentally tougher, and it's just physically tougher as well. Which is why, like, I'm a huge advocate. Like you said, you get more opportunities as well. I went to JUCO, and then started my freshman year. I didn't play like every single game, but I played most of the games. And then sophomore year, I was a main starter. And I don't think I was ready to go any four-year schools, to be honest.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Which is why I'm a big advocate for that, because most guys, like you said, age does matter. You know, especially at such a young age, makes a huge difference on your development.
Mm.
Like 1 year makes a huge fucking change, right? That's why guys go from, you know, not getting drafted out of high school and go to like 3 years out of whatever school and they get drafted.
Yep.
JUCO guys too, same thing. They just go there and get drafted higher, way higher or whatever. You know, like things like that happen for a reason, because you can develop, you can play, you can get your innings in instead of not doing shit. Like you go to D1, you sit out, you get what? Maybe if as a freshman, you get 15 at bats, you know, and then you, and then that's it. What have you got to do better? You know, like
the one thing that I really think people don't focus on enough is going to JUCO gives you the ability to make a decision out of like power rather than weakness. Where it gives you the ability to be patient, it allows you to develop and understand what's going on. And then you can sit there and, you know, at the end of your 2 years at JUCO, you know whether or not you can go play at a certain level.
Right. Well, it's an ego play a lot of times in high school, right?
It's
like,
it's a force.
I'm a sophomore in high school and I just committed D1.
Right.
Because I'm a pitcher throwing 89 as a sophomore.
Right.
So those D1s, like when you get on the back side of it and you look and you're like, oh, I see what they were doing.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
They just give them a scholarship.
Yep.
And then they say, well, watch how he develops, because we assume that he'll be throwing 94, 95.
Hopefully.
If they don't, they bang him.
Yep. And so you end up as a senior throwing 88, and they're like, well, you didn't really develop. We take your scholarship away. Now you don't have any other offers because all the other schools thought you were committed.
Yeah.
And so now this like ego play of I'm a sophomore going to a D1 or I'm going to a D1 regardless of my age, like now you're behind other kids.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think two things happen. One, the player gets complacent a lot of times because like, oh, I already got it made. I'm already going D1. Yep. I'm good. And then also they miss what's actually best for them at the time when they're coming out of high school. Because what's best for you when you're a sophomore might not be what's best when you're a senior. Exactly.
Or people just catch up. You know,
well, that's it too. Yeah. And that's kind of what we're talking about here in the first place. Like you get an extra year of development. All of a sudden you can pass that guy up that went to the D1, got eight at bats his freshman year.
Exactly.
And you got 200 in JUCO, and then like all of a sudden you're going to the D1 and taking his spot because you just developed for a year.
That was the biggest thing, where it's like actually playing college baseball on a regular basis, it's a very unique thing to do early
on.
It's
so fun.
Like, but what you do, it's a great time, but it's very hard. Like, you have to be good.
Yeah.
And you have to, and that's where a lot of people, they put themselves out there like, oh, I'm good enough to make a D1 roster.
Right.
Great. Play. Like, that's the only way, like, your ultimate goal is to play professionally. You're not going to do that sitting on the bench or being, like, a scholarship athlete that doesn't play.
At the end of the day, for me, wherever I was going, there's no way I'm going to go somewhere and not going to play.
Yep.
Because if you don't play, for me, the the reason I play baseball is because I'm good at playing baseball, and I enjoy playing baseball. Like, I don't want to go, so I don't give a fuck if it's a fucking top five D1. Yeah. I don't give a shit. If I go there, don't do shit for a year, and there's a fucking junior that's in my position that's going to get drafted, you're not going to play. You're just not going to play. Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure, you're gonna get their gear or whatever in the fall ball. Yeah, sure, they get sick gear or whatever, and you got fucking 15 at-bats. What the fuck have you done? Yeah. You hit a little bit of weights, and that's it? Great. Then what?
Yeah.
I went to JUCO. I had 200 at-bats, you know,
and
I faced great fucking competition.
Yep.
I got stronger, better, and now I got a better offer to go to another school that I can actually go play.
Yeah.
You know, and you'd be amazed how many DMs I get because I'm the king of JUCO. All the kids that get exactly the situation you're saying, oh, you know, dude, I was signed with, I really literally just got a DM. Dude, I was committed to a Stetson. They banged me. Now I'm going to JUCO. Mm-hmm. Fuck them. And I'm like, great. But how many of those do I get? I get literally tens of hundreds of those like a week. You know, it's incredible that how many schools, like a big D1 programs or whatever, they fucking sign them, mm-hmm. bang them at the last minute. They don't give a fuck. You know, they just want the right players for their program, which is fine.
Yeah.
And the player get fucked and then they're like, oh, now I don't even have another choice. But now, because like I'm speaking a little more about the JUCO situation, I think the stigma is a little bit changing and in a positive way, in my opinion, just so that people are like, oh, I'm gonna choose JUCO instead of forcing to go to JUCO.
Well, the mindset,
for me, it was the only way.
The mindset that is established in a place like that, that person goes through a situation where I bet before they got dropped, they're sitting there like, ah, oh, D1 guy, like, yeah, I'm pretty good. Then they get dropped and they're like, that stings.
Yeah.
And they go to a JUCO and they're like, all right, I got 2 years to like, prove it to these people.
That's right.
They're like, Stetson, whatever. Yeah. You know? And so that's the same thing where I think for a lot of people who might not have that fire going, or like they want to maybe, it is something that's palpable when you walk into that situation. You have a lot of people that are there for a bunch of different reasons, whether it be a monetary reason, they can't afford to do anything else, and they want to like go there to possibly get a better scholarship somewhere else. There's a situation of a development stage. It's just a lot of like from a actual, say, a variety of people that are there. It's a very great learning experience for people to actually like get that inner kind of gumption kind of piece to it.